Hello and welcome to this Gramophone podcast with me, James Jolly. The July issue is on sale with Lang Lang adorning the cover to tie in with his Proms appearances this summer. Coming up in this podcast, Martin Cullingford talks to Edward Higginbottom about the new record label from New College, Oxford, Novum, and their forthcoming disc of the Mozart Requiem. And James Inverne met up with the Maltese tenor Joseph Calleja. In the new magazine, David Gutman considers the numerous recordings of Sibelius's Second Symphony and makes some suggestions for versions to live with. And talking of recordings, I caught up with the pianist Kirill Gerstein, who is in London performing Rachmaninov. Gerstein is a passionate and clearly highly discerning record collector, and one of the first things he bought when he arrived in the United States from his native Russia was the RCA set of the complete recordings by Sergei Rachmaninov. And Rachmaninov the pianist was the subject of our conversation.
I would say what fascinates me the most is the incredible sense of timing. Timing within a phrase and timing within the piece on a large scale. But it's such a combination of logic and unpredictability at the same time, and sort of setting up three possible expectations and taking one of them, but you expect the other. So you're constantly pleasantly surprised as a listener and therefore interested, but at the same time it's logical, it's not willful. And I believe from what we know about his working process, and in some way what you I think can discern from the playing, is that it's very calculated playing. It's inspired, has a great heart, all the romantic attributes that one reads about, but it is very calculated. It's very masterfully calculated that you think it's not calculated, that it's very...
So the art that conceals art.
Yeah. And I think this is often the best examples of interpretation, I find, is when things seem so logical and you think, well, you know, there's not the constructed background behind. So it's very hard to lift the sort of the glossy layer off, but there's very much calculation work behind Rachmaninoff's playing, I think is certain. But this sense of timing, this almost on a per note basis, you know, one note promises a faster flow, the other note pulls at the same time, and the third note is a harmonically important one, and it gives you a push that shoves you into the next phrase. And this I find is amazing. And every time I come back to these recordings, I hear more stuff in it. And so I think sort of the better you listen or the more experience you get, it grows in dimensions of what's in there. So it's somehow a very compressed, multi-dimensional experience, these Rachmaninov recordings. And somehow this is more, I think that's fairly, for me, fairly objective. The more subjective response I always get is that you can't phrase the way Rachmaninov phrases if you're a small person, like small-minded or petty. You know, there's nothing petty in this playing. It's so big and grand, but it's not without the fine small details. So it somehow combines all these layers, but there is nothing petty about this man. So he plays according to his size, I think, to the size of the heart, to the size of his reported height, to the size of his hands. Strong stones in the interpretation. I think it's so based on structure, and structure is so clear and so exposed in how he plays also his own pieces. So I think the third concerto or any of the other pieces don't sound so complicated with him, like they manage to sound sometimes when you hear other pianists playing, oh, this is a million notes, but he's so clear about which ones are the important and where the trends are going. So this could be said that this is really a composer playing, because he's very clear about what are the turning points, and those are the things that the whole playing is based on. And this is what he finds in other composers, and this is what's so fascinating. And and sort of think some of the dynamic changes in the slow movement of Chopin's Second Sonata. This is sometimes he's on par with the composer, and he says, yes, this could be like this, but it also could be like this. It presents a very strong, different version of possibilities. So yes, I think Rachmaninoff is one of the most important pianists of probably of all time. I think sort of after Liszt and Anton Rubinstein and Busoni, I think Rachmaninoff is one of that company of the best people that touched the instrument.
Rachmaninoff's third piano concerto played there by the composer in 1939 with the Philadelphia Orchestra conducted by Eugene Ormandy. And earlier we heard part of Schumann's Carnival, again played by Rachmaninoff. I was talking to the pianist Kirill Gerstein, who appears at the Proms this year playing Richard Strauss's Burlesque. That's on August the 26th. Another prom, this time on July the 24th, features one of the hottest young singers on the international circuit, the Maltese tenor Joseph Calleja. He first caught the attention of record buffs with a highly regarded recital disc back in 2004, followed quickly by a second album. And then nothing. Gramophone's editor James Inverne met up with him in Munich after Calleja had just sung in performances of La Bohème and asked him where he'd been.
I didn't go away. What I did was I stopped recording for an obvious reason. When I first signed with Decca, I was 24 years old. And it's wonderful for press to have such a young tenor, and it's all well and good. But was I ready artistically and maturity-wise? I think the honest answer has to be no. And I stopped recording because had I continued, first of all, I exhausted all the repertoire I was singing on stage. If you get two albums, put them together, there was nothing else I could possibly add in terms of opera unless I moved ahead with heavier repertoire. And was I ready to do that? Absolutely not. And I gambled. I played a card. I said, okay, I'm going to stop, whatever the repercussions are, and focus on my live performances and focus on my maturity, focus on learning and making the good mistakes, as I call them, because you learn a lot from good mistakes. And then when I was ready again, I went back. I said, can we do this? And the reply was yes, and we did it. And I am very proud of this recording because it shows an artist in his first, let's say, golden years. I mean, in the first set of, I mean, there are different stages. And for sure, the stage is where I became a full lyric and where the voice has acquired a round quality, exciting top notes, without losing the timbre which I had and without losing the flexibility, the diminuendo, the ability to sing piano and to give nuance to the different fraseggio as required by the different repertoire.
Do you also feel, and this might be a difficult question for you to answer, but to me your voice sounds, I mean this in the best way possible, it sounds old-fashioned is the wrong term, but it sounds like the kind of voice that we got in the 1950s, 1960s, with singers like Giuseppe Campora, yeah, to whom you sound very similar, which is a compliment because he was always a favourite of mine. But at a time when not every singer had to have absolutely even and identical vocal production, but the voice was allowed more flexibility and more uniqueness, I suppose. Do you feel that now we have singers such as yourself and also Jonas Kaufmann, who in a different way is also unconventional, that once again people have opened up to more kinds of Italian tenor?
I think that the three prerequisites for a voice to be called a star voice or a great voice, it has to be beautiful, even if in an unconventional way, but it has to be beautiful. It has to be recognizable and hence unique. If you have those three qualities, I think they're a pretty safe indicator that you will be picked up from the crowd. Mm. If you sound the same, like, and everyone else, despite being beautiful, you will never receive recognition. You will never be recognizable. I think that those are the three things that a voice must have, together with, of course, the technical aspect, the schooling, the knowing the style you're singing in. But those are prerequisites, which I think are very important, and quite frankly, it makes opera interesting and exciting.
And also, with the recording industry these days tending to favour arias discs, I mean, as they always did, but there being fewer, certainly fewer studio complete opera recordings and fewer in general anyway, it seems to me that that if you have a unique voice and a distinctive voice, it's going to be better suited to arias discs, because otherwise they're all going to sound like a production line, which perhaps was the case for a while. How do you struggle with the challenge of bringing a different interpretation to each role when you're effectively dealing with 4 or 5 or 6 minute bites?
Concentration. When you're doing a studio recording, you don't have the scenery, costumes and theater atmosphere to help you with the audience. So what I do is I literally go somewhere quiet pre the session and think. And I don't think, okay, now it's Joseph Calleja trying to be the Greer. No, I'm gonna literally be the Greer, and how would I interpret this? And I don't say this as a cliche, you know, for the interview to sound all to say the right things at the right time. But it's really my reality that when I approach the studio, and there's the fabulous conductor Marco Armiliato, who was a huge help in doing this record. I, you know, we go in a room beforehand, and we go through the aria on the piano, and I really try to put all the concentration necessary to immerse myself, albeit temporarily, in the role, and to be able to give, just with the audio aspect, all the interpretation, all the emotions in the aria I'm recording. And I have to say, what helped a lot in this recording, and I say this with utter honesty, is that we tried to make it as wholesome and complete as possible. There isn't a lot of editing. The editing has been kept down to a minimum because I want to give a realistic approach to the arias. And many repetitions, for example, we did Kajelda Manina in a take and a half. And the many repetitions we did in the studio had more to do with me moving the stand, or me not standing in the right distance from the microphone. Some orchestra member did a small mistake, which of course on a studio recording cannot be tolerated. It was more about that than us having difficulty to record the arias.
We've mentioned Malta a couple of times. How musical is Malta? Because we don't hear much about that, and how much did that influence you musically?
There's a huge choral tradition in Malta, and there are composers like Charles Camilleri, who died recently, who had achieved some level of notoriety abroad. There's another composer who also has compositions which are played occasionally in Europe, Joseph Vella, Maestro Joseph Vella. They do interesting stuff. Of course, as I said, Malta is the size of a medium, of a medium smallish sized city in the UK, and so one has to be realistic by the number of people that come out and have international careers. The other singers throughout history, there was Oreste Kirkop, and I was going to mention Mario Lanza, because Oreste Kirkop took over Mario Lanza on the film The Vagabond King, when Lanza was having some issues. There was my teacher, Paul Ashak, who had a very distinguished career in the UK. He was one of the pioneers of Welsh National Opera. He's one of the pioneers in Wexford and in Dublin as well, and of course London, at the Royal Opera House and with the company Sadler's Wells. And he was in that famous, I think 1952, correct me if I'm wrong, production of Norma with Maria Callas.
I think you're right.
And with Joan Sutherland, when she was singing the mezzo role of Clotilda, and my teacher was Flavio. Then he proceeded to do their Radames, Fanciulla del West, etc. So they're for such a small island to have in the last 60 years. Then there's Miriam Gauci, the soprano, who had a very distinguished career in the 80s and 90s.
Yes, recorded quite a lot as well.
Recorded quite a lot on Naxos. And there must be something in the water, because almost everyone in Malta sings or like to sing. I mean, not opera just, but you know, pop, rock, whatever. But there's huge musical talent that if they would do, I think, some kind of research, they would find an abnormal average where good voices are concerned.
Part of Rodolfo's Act II aria from Verdi's Luisa Miller. It was sung by Joseph Calleja on his new Decca album, The Maltese Tenor. Marco Armiliato conducted the Suisse Romande Orchestra, and Calleja was talking to James Inverne. Now, we've had own-label recordings from orchestras, concert halls, soloists, choirs, but never Oxford colleges until now. Gramophone's online editor, Martin Cullingford, went to Oxford to talk to Edward Higginbottom about New College's new label, Novum.
Perhaps the first thing to say is it's not exclusive. We still do work with other companies, and we have a project with Decca presently in the process of production. So it was a way of having part of our recorded identity under entirely our control. You might say that it was in part because it's nice to be able to decide what you want to do when you want to do it. And if you're going to be in that position, you have to pay for it. In addition, we were finding that when recording for other companies, we were being asked to find some funding. So if we are sponsoring some of the costs, or in fact a large number of the costs, it does make sense to own the product in the end. So that's what we've done. Mm-hmm. So it's artistic ownership, and of course it's also a financial issue. Not that we're going to go rich on this. I think my business model is rather sort of odd. It would strike anybody odd who was wanting to make money. We try to amortize all the costs for any project at the point where we're actually making the record, so that when we sell it, we're always replenishing the coffer rather than catching up, in a manner of speaking. But that requires, you know, some generous sponsorship as we go through.
And the next recording is of Mozart's Requiem, which is an unusual approach to the work.
There are several things we've sort of highlighted as why we, or how we are going to proceed with the choice of repertory. And one of the types of work we're going to take on is the iconic warhorse, but done differently. So that's the category into which the Mozart Requiem falls. And then another might be unusually or neglected or hitherto unrecorded music. And we just recorded in March music by François Couperin that's never been recorded before, that required some completion of string parts which are not extant. So that's a contribution of a different sort. Anyway, to get back to Mozart. Mozart, you will ordinarily hear sung by a choir, but with a group of soloists who have probably little relation to that choir. They've been bussed in, and they may be very good, but for certain, they don't emerge from the choral sound perspective, nor perhaps do they emerge in terms of style. So for us, it was very important that we had that sense of the solo stepping forward from the choral ranks. Now, that sounds rather, these voices are merely step forward, but you've got to make sure that when they do step forward, they can do a really good job. And we've got a marvellous quartet. I mean, I think they really are very good. They do a superb job on this music. Boy, soprano, boy, alto, tenor and a bass. And the ages run from 12 through to 22. So another aspect of it, which is, if you like, important to us at least, is it's about what you can do with young people and what you can achieve with them. So I think we get a particular approach, a particular sound world, sort of approach which is very flexible and examines the music afresh, because these people, they're coming to the Mozart Requiem, some of them, for the first time. So it is fresh. And then when you mix it in with an orchestra like the Age of Enlightenment, you've got a good mixture of skills, insights, and a particular way of tackling the work, which I think means it's going to be different from anybody else's.
And you've been putting even songs up on your website for webcasts, which is another wonderful way of reaching new audiences with what goes on here.
Yep, we do that. We release one a week. We just record everything, and then we pick one that's sort of a different night of the week or some interesting music on it, or Or indeed, we might decide that we prefer one because everything's gone absolutely perfectly rather than very well. So we might make a selection on that basis.
And do the boys, have they settled into that? They don't feel an extra sense of nerves? Or is it perhaps a very healthy thing just to be constantly doing it in that recorded environment?
Yeah, we're totally not aware of it because it's a constant.
Mm.
So, yeah, there's no sense, oh gosh, this is being recorded. We just try and do a you know, decent or better than decent service every time we go in. And that's that.
Edward Higginbottom, thank you very much.
Great pleasure.
Part of the Mozart Requiem in the new recording on the Novum label, New College Oxford's own label. Edward Higginbottom conducted the choir of New College and the orchestra of the Age of Enlightenment. And that recording's just out and already in the specialist classical chart. And find out about those charted discs every week on the Gramophone website at gramophone.co.uk. Well, that's all for this month. Remember that you can find Gramophone on the newsstand near you, but you can also read Gramophone on your iPad, tablet or laptop via the new Gramophone app in a digital edition. Full information at gramophone.co.uk.